What is the one thing that a friend did that made you realize that they have simply been using you throughout your friendship? What was the last straw? Had a best friend who was really needy and had a new crisis every few weeks. I'd routinely drop everything to comfort her or to help her with whatever speed bump her dramatic life threw at her. In hindsight, everything was a huge hurdle for her, probably just to add drama to her own life. It was like she couldn't be happy with anything. Anyway, last year I had a huge health scare with a rare autoimmune condition that attacks your nerves. Basically, within a few weeks I lost the ability to walk and was in so much agony I couldn't sleep. It was terrifying and took 4 months for them to diagnose. 4 months of wondering if I would ever walk again or if I was dying slowly and horribly. After 1 month of me being sick, I just stopped hearing from her. By month 3 I was in hospital, which she found out because she ran into a mutual friend. She called me and chatted for about half an hour and then just disappeared and ghosting me. 5 months later I get a message acting like nothing had happened, asking if another mutual acquaintance was a tradie so she could try and get mates rates. She didn't even ask if I was doing okay. I confirmed the guy's tradie status and washed my hands of her. I don't have any ill will towards her, but I've learned that life is short and you should be careful with who you invest your time in. I now spend the massive amount of energy that her friendship cost on people who will come through in a crisis instead. There's always that one friend who uses you for transportation because you're the only one with a car willing to haul their asses around. Haha. Eventually you get tired, tell them you're not giving them rides anymore, and they're the ones ending the friendship with you. So it all works out in the end. When you tell a friend no, and they either guilt you or lose their shit. She was always having a crisis no matter what. After 10 plus years of friendship, it finally got to me. She forgot her favorite shirt on our vacation. She got sand in her suit at the beach. She was too hot. She didn't like how things smelled, etc. She was 23 years old and she was crying because she got sand in her butt at the beach. After she got home, she messaged me and said how much she hated visiting me in FL and how she wasted her time. Another friend and I paid for her plane ticket. I realized that me trying to smooth over every problem in her life was never going to be enough, so I gave up. I haven't spoken to her in months and I don't plan to. She used me for attention, and I got tired of babysitting her. I really hate that phrase, but it's the only thing that describes it. Close bracket. In school, I had a hard time telling when I was being taken advantage of. I was kind of shy and nerdy, and a couple kids used that by pretending to be my friend so they could get things. My mom was a single mother doing the best she could, and as a nurse she worked long shifts. That meant some nights she wouldn't be home until I was in bed. Becky, my neighbor down the road, who was a year above me, noticed my mom's car was rarely there. She was hot by my little redneck hometown standards. And so when she sat with me one day on the bus, I was flabbergasted. She chatted me up, asking what I like to do after school. When I said I mostly just played Sparks, she said her friend Paul did too, and that we should all hang out and play Halo. I agreed. Later that night, the two of them rode bikes to my house and spent a couple hours on Blood Gulch. Paul was a senior, and as a freshman I felt so cool to be hanging with him, even though he barely talked to me and just dominated me in kills. Next week, Becky asked to do it again. I readily agreed. This time though, after the first couple games, Paul pulled out a bag of weed and a bowl, and without even asking took a hit and passed it to Becky. Becky offered it to me, and I said I couldn't cause of my asthma, so the two of them smoked it. Later, after they left, I febreezed the hell out of my room. It became a regular thing of them coming over, smoking weed in my room and playing Sparks couple times a week. One day, when I came back from making popcorn for them, they were making out on my bed. I cleared my throat, and Paul just said I could keep playing single player. It was awkward playing and pretending they weren't dry humping 3 feet from me. The next time Paul brought over GTA San Andreas, he said I could play it and they'd just watch. Of course, as I played, they made the beast with two backs on my bed. To say it was weird was an understatement. The next time Becky mentioned coming over, I worked up the balls to say that I felt awkward with them making out and doing other stuff in my house. She seemed let down, but promised it wouldn't happen. Her and Paul still came over and smoked Anne. To her credit, when Paul tried to start getting frisky, she shut him down. He got upset with this, and after 20 minutes or so, suddenly remembered he had to go home. So they left. That Friday, Becky said she had a surprise for when we hung out later. When her and Paul showed up, they had Becky's cousin Kelly, who went to another school, with them. If you want to picture her, just mentally age honeyboo, boo up to 16. They also brought a bottle of cheap blackberry brandy. We sat in my living room, and I had my first drink of alcohol. It was horrible, but I wanted to fit in. Kelly was sitting next to me on the couch, while Becky sat on Paul's lap in the Lazy Boy. We were listening to Paul's Limp Bizkit CDs. Becky started wiggling a bit on Paul's lap, and then said she needed to use the bathroom. A minute later, Paul wordlessly got up and went down the hall too. Now it was me and Kelly awkwardly listening as Fred Durst shouted over no metal beats. Kelly finished the last of the brandy and then made her move. She put her hand on the inseam of my cargo shorts and just started kneading away like she was trying to make a Play-Doh snake. It didn't feel great, but at that age, any attention made my soldier salute. She leaned in and sloppily tried to shove a tongue down my throat. She just kept kneading away at my junk, and she was wearing at least 3 rings. So it hurt a bit, but also felt good. I had never been this far before. And after only a few minutes, there was a stain on my carcass. I didn't know what to do next, so just kept tongue dueling with Kelly. That's when Becky came down the hall with Paul in tow, saying they needed to leave. It was weird, but at the same time I was glad I didn't have to figure out what to do next. When I recovered from my post-orgasm slightly drunk state, I went to change my shorts and discovered why the hasty retreat. Apparently Becky and Paul once again had sex on my bed, but Becky's aunt Flo was visiting, and there was a large stain on my sheets and duvet. I gagged a bit, but threw all my linens and my shorts in the washing machine. Unfortunately, Kelly had left the brandy bottle in the living room. When my mom eventually got home, she noticed it. I got yelled at for drinking for a good hour, and compared to my no good alcoholic father, I didn't tell her I had people over. That would have made it worse. I was grounded for a month. To make matters worse, those rings had bruised my elephant trunk something fierce. Coach noticed during penis inspection, and I had to stay after 4 gym detention. Becky was so mortified by what had happened, she stopped talking to me altogether. I realized they were just using me for a hangout spot. When she made fun of me for getting my permit recently, my parents never made it essential for me to get one, but when I told them, she just joked about how sad that is, that a person my age finally gets a license. Mind you, I'm 20. I realized she used me as a punching bag to deal with her lack of self-confidence. They used me because I worked hard and had a good paycheck. They thought if they hung out with me, they'd get whatever they wanted. So when I never bought them anything anymore, they never came back around. The clearest sign somebody is just using you: they're always there when they need something from you. But the moment you ask them for something when you're in need, suddenly they can't make it. Sorry. So has friends like this. She's the type to bend over backward for anybody in need, and boy do people take advantage of it. Then she fell on hard times and put a call out for help. Some of them literally told her to fuck off. She got back on her feet and had a big paycheck coming in. Guess who was lined up with their hand out? Yup, they were literally gathered in our front yard, making demands. Wow. I reminded her of each and every one of them telling her to fuck off when she was in hard times. So she told them all to hit the road. Oh. Man, did they ever call her names. Some of them even threatened to beat her up. Are you going to let my kids go hungry? You sick bitch, you make 3 times more money than she does. If they are going hungry, you're the one who's a sick fucking bitch. Get the fuck out of here before I call the cops. She's getting better and better about not feeling bad when users and abusers are mad at her. She wasn't using me financially or anything, but more like an emotional outlet and representation of high school almost. I could come over for 3 hours and spend that whole time just listening to her rant and rave about how she's so glad we graduated. And do you remember this person? What a bitch she was. Hey, are you still in university? Gross, why would you do that? She had a group of older friends, we were 18 over 19, and they were around 25, who she was so super proud of hanging out with. She thought they were all the hottest shit. Bragged about all the drugs they gave her. How mature they were. How none of them needed university or college degrees, and proof of how that was just a racket. Don't entirely disagree, but the only one of them who wasn't working a minimum wage retail slash fast food job was working a family business. And most of them lived at home. Close bracket. They were all also majorly into the alternative scene. So piercings, tattoo, Satanism, all that. I don't personally dress like that, but I listened to similar music and was totally down with it. Fuck. My partner has a couple face piercings too, and a sleeve, so. My friend could not stop bringing up how normal and safe I was, and how weird and cool her new friend group was. I remember one time we were hanging out with a couple of her friends, and one of them was acting pretty cooky, and I was laughing and playing along. Then my friend said, "Let's tone it down. She won't get it. She doesn't hang around cool people. All her friends are normal." And when I looked at her, she was like, "Well, you know, your friends X and Y. Totally bores, which is cool, but you don't really get exposure to people like us." Bitch, what? Total bores. Then she continued to go on, but how hard it was to have piercings and tattoos, and how people would judge them on first look. And they'd people giving them dirty glares. And it's so hard for someone normal to understand what it's like to be hated. I was one of the only brown people in our high school, and one of the only brown families in our town. She knew all the stuff I had to go through, that my family did. I didn't understand what it was like to be hated automatically. For someone who never got over high school, she pretty quickly forgot what it was like for her supposed best friend. And then I realized that she never really knew. Our whole relationship was me giving her my time and effort. Being there for her in every capacity I could. I'd open up my home to her when her parents kicked her out. I came back from university the weekend her father died to help her. And then again during his funeral. His funeral that none of her new shiny friends showed up to, but her dreaded high school friends did. I stopped reaching out to her, and she never tried to bridge that gap. I bumped into her when I came home to visit once, and she spent 30 minutes catching me up with her life and then said bye. That whole time she never once asked about me, how I was doing. We hadn't talked in 2 years at that point. This was longer than I expected, but I never really got the chance to put it all together. They only wanted to hang out when they needed things. The first time I noticed it, she asked to hang out, but she was at her friend's house about 30 minutes from my house. I go pick her up. We go to my house, aren't even there an hour, and she remembers she had to be home for dinner. So I drive her home, 20 minutes in the other direction. So 50 minutes of me driving alone, 50 of driving around with her, and maybe 50 hanging out at my place. Found out later she had gone to her boyfriend's house without asking. Her mom refused to get her, and her boyfriend didn't have gas money to take her home. The one that broke the camel's back, however, was a few months later. It's winter and I get a call that she wants to hang out. I say sure. Drive to her house. When I get there, she tells me her different boyfriend needed to get home so he could get to work. Her mom wasn't home to drive them, and his parents were at work. We were like 18 over 19 here. She said she'd give me some money to drive them to his place about. I say I'll do it, because I don't want to look like an asshole. So we start driving. It's normally a 30 minute drive, but about 10 minutes and the snow starts picking up. A couple minutes later, it's almost a whiteout. The plows haven't been through yet, so there is accumulated snow on the road. At one point I couldn't see the road and use the phone poles to navigate. I went off the road once, but we got unstuck easily. We get to the turn off to his road, and again it hadn't been plowed. It might as well not be there. I'm in a Ford Taurus and the snow is almost up to the bumper. I pull into his driveway, and through the blowing snow I can see his mom in the house. I try to leave his driveway, get stuck and have to be pushed out by him and his dad, who came out to help. I head back down the road using my tracks from before, behind a guy who has his friend walking in the snow next to him so he can see. I get to where I would turn onto the main road, and the good news is the plow went through. The bad news, it packed a wall of snow in the intersection that is above the hood of my car or the one in front of me. Luckily, the guy across the street had a plow on his truck and unfucked the road. The ride back was better as the road was plowed and salted. And by the time I got back to town, you wouldn't have known it was a frozen hellscape a few miles north. Probably spent 2 hours all totaled. Found out the blizzard had been ongoing, which is why his parents hadn't come to get him. My friend knew this.